Hello and welcome back to Apes and Engines. And today we have a very special guest on, Teapot One. I'm sure some of you, I would imagine all of you have heard of Teapot One. If you haven't, you're probably living under a rock. A man who went around the world on a Gixxer 1000, which, by the way, I still think you're insane for doing.
How we doing, folks? Ah, cheers, man. Cheers. Yeah, it seems like a different life, that. But yeah, she's still there. She's still downstairs.
Still there. Does it start anymore?
It would if I need to put a new battery in it. Put a new battery and change the fluids, and yeah, she'll start no problem at all. I think the last time I rode the Gixxer was to the first Overland event back in, I think that was June, July 2015, and that's where I launched the book. So yeah, that was the last time I rode it. So yeah, she's just been sat in the garage since.
And is, like, how did the frame fare? Actually, no, we'll save that. I have that question written down for later. Do you want to, for just in case anyone has been living under a rock, do you want to do a quick intro to your channel and what it's about now?
Yeah, cool. Teapot One started back in sort of, I think, 2012 for the round the world trip. And the idea behind it was just to document my trip for myself, for family, for friends, that sort of thing. And it got a little bit of a following when I was away, nothing massive. I think I had about 600 subs by the time I finished the trip. I was away for about, well, I was away for 442 days, year and a half. And then I sort of left it, didn't do much, well, did nothing with it until end of 2016. And then I just thought, I missed this, you know, I missed the interaction with people. I really missed that. So I just started doing vids again end of 2016, and it's grown to where it is now. So yeah, it's all about bikes, but my thing is live your life. That's my little tagline. Something my mom said to me, I'm sure we'll probably cover it in the chat, but it's something my mom said to me, and it stuck with me, that ethos, live your life. So I try to get out there, do as much as I can, and generally it's always around bikes and travel, that sort of stuff.
It's funny, actually. I was only telling a couple of lads in work today that, you know, you were coming on the podcast, and I don't think any of them knew your channel, but I told them a bit about your story then. And it's funny because that resonated with everyone, the live your life thing. And obviously, look, I've been following the channel between not having a YouTube account, which I do feel bad about now that I do YouTube myself, because I never liked videos or anything. You know, I just knew the names and I'd search them and watch them. But I would imagine a few of them are probably going to go have a look at your videos tonight, because it really,
awesome.
I don't know, that just grabs attention, I think, that story, which is, obviously it's a sad and a happy story that, you know, you went and did it, I think.
Yeah, definitely. You know, it's, for anyone that doesn't know anything about it, basically my mom was losing her battle with cancer, and just one day I started moaning. Long Way Around came on the TV and I started to moan, and she turned around to me and she said, look, you've always spoke about, I didn't ride a bike at this point, you've always spoke about riding a bike, you've always spoke about travel, don't get to my stage where you face the end and, you know, you regret what you've not done. So live your life, you know, look after those that you love, but live your life. And stuck with me ever since.
I think you've done that, to be honest. And it's fair play to you. But like, cheers. It's mad when I looked at your channel. Like, I genuinely, like, I don't remember. Like I said, I used to pay no attention to subs or anything like that when I watched videos. But I've always watched YouTube. But when I went back, and this is something I like to do, I go back. Anyone who I have on, I look at, you know, their channel from when it started, whatever else. And I love watching the first video. So it's actually, I have a comment from your very first video that you uploaded to the channel, and I'll get to it in a sec. But
oh, wow.
So nine years ago was your first upload, and it was in 240p was the max resolution.
Jeez, was it?
It's mad. It was, yeah, it was. Boy. And you know, from there, you know what? Last I checked today, you 38,400 subscribers. Now, like, that's relatively on YouTube, I think that's way lower than it should be. But at the same time, I think it's mad that, you know, that's 40,000 people, you know, felt enough of a connection to click the subscribe button. And I still...
Blows your mind, doesn't it? Just blows
insane.
Your
it's
mind.
Insane. Yeah. Like, I don't think, you know, if you put a crowd of the amount of people who are subscribed to me in front of me, number one, I don't do crowds well, so I'd have a full freak out. I can't even imagine, like, that's a stadium full of people, 40,000 people, you know?
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it?
It is. But that, and not only that, 3.2 million plus views. and 192 videos on your YouTube channel. So that's over what, 9 years ago, I think I said your first upload was. So number one, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
And it's just bit crazy. But to start it off, right, your first video, you said when you were planning the trip, I don't know, it'll probably take me 10 years to complete. And I laughed when I heard it, because it's nearly 10 years on from that video. So how do you feel like after completing the Road of the World trip, after doing that planning all that time ago, and to where you are now, you know, kind of, would you do it again? If you went back to that day 9 years ago, would you do it again? Or is there anything you'd change?
Absolutely. But that, initially, I used to say, when I came back, when people asked, would you do it again? I always said, well, no, because I've done it. You know, I've lived the dream now. I've done it. So why go back and do it? But the last couple of years, definitely. You know, last couple of years, I've just been, I've got unfinished business here. I need to go back and do some more. So, you know, it comes down to money. At the end of the day, it comes down to money, you know, and I literally sold everything I owned and I remortgaged, and, you know, you put your life on hold for a trip like that. And I'm only now starting to pay off the credit card loans and pay off family that lent me money to go and do it. So that's all cleared. But obviously now I've left the old bill, I've jumped ship, I'm self-employed. So there's other challenges ahead.
So, you know,
absolutely. Especially now.
I will do it.
I thought, well, I hope you do, and I'll be here to watch it when you do. And maybe even run as a support vehicle. It's funny that, you know, you went full time YouTube and then this happened. I was like, ah, for God's sake, like, this is just, you know, you couldn't write that.
I know. My last official day in the old bill was the 21st of March. That was my last day. And it was the 22nd, I think, was in the news. The 22nd was like, oh shit, we're in a world of pain here. And, you know, and the lockdown was coming, and I was just like, oh, what have I done? Because I lost like two or three sponsors that same week. Just because they were like, God, we've, one is Canary Motorcycle Tours. They're based out in the Canaries, and obviously Spain had shut down, so they had no customers coming in. So they were like, look, I'm really sorry, but we can do this month, but we're gonna have to put a hold on anything after that. So, you know, it's totally understandable. Another one was Cali Moto App. It's a German company. They'd gone into lockdown, so they had no customer base now. So it was, everyone basically just grabbed hold of the purse and went, oh, we need to see what's gonna happen. And then I've got a flat that I rent as well. My two tenants both got laid off exactly the same day. So it was like, oh no, what have I done?
Yeah. Well, I hope you don't get too hurt by it. But
no, it's all good. It's all good. We're okay.
Have you seen a drop off in Patreons actually?
No,
that's good.
Honestly, man, that has just blown. I mean, the whole support on Patreon blown my mind, because you think to yourself, why will people pay money to, you know, to effectively for something that you can get for free on YouTube anyway? But the support there and from people has just been incredible, absolutely incredible. Especially at this time when I thought people would cut back on their expenditure, it's gone up because people are like, you know, we really appreciate the vids and the podcasts, and, you know, they're like, you're helping us through this, so here you are. And people have increased their pledges, and it's just been amazing.
That's funny. Talking as someone, I don't know how many people I currently patron, and it's actually funny. It's something that bothers me that I can't give my favorites more, if that makes sense, because I'm like, I have it spread out, and I'm like, is it really helping? Is it really helping? But it was funny. I talked to Suburban Delinquent before. Now, not like this, just as a chat. And I was like, it was on Patreon. And I said, look, yeah, I'd love to give you more, but I can't. And he was like, all of the dollars are nearly the best part. Because he said, you know, there's lots of people who do the dollars. He said, the big lumps are great, but he's like, if I didn't have all those little dollars, it'd be.
Yeah, that's the crazy thing, isn't it? You know, people say, well, you know, what's the point of me giving $1 a month? But, and you're like, but if you think about it, $1 a month, if 100 people do, that's $100 a month coming in. If 1,000, that's 1,000. I know some folk who've got like 8,000, 10,000 patrons. And even if they're only giving $1, that's a lot of money coming in. And then that people like Chase on Two Wheels, you know, that then allows them to, you know, his channel, he buys insurance right off bikes, does them up, and then gives them away. And he can only do that because of the support he gets through the likes of Patreon.
I love what he does on Patreon.
And that's awesome, isn't it?
It's funny because I see so many people complaining. It's like, oh, we can't win the bikes. We can't win the bikes. It's like, that's not the point. Like, even look at, for someone like Brian to be on YouTube fixing up the bikes with Chase, like, even, like, I've learned so much just watching it. You know what I mean? Yeah. And it's great to see that. But I think to kind of go back to that really quickly, and I didn't have this on my list, so it's funny that it came up with the patron stuff. The reason, from someone who patrons quite a few people, the reason I do it is I looked at it ages ago, and I could have went and got Sky and paid way too much money a month and all that stuff. And I don't watch anything else. You know what I mean? Yeah. I watch YouTube, and I was like, well, you know, if I'm going to do that, I may as well pay them because I want them to keep doing it. And it's even the same as, you know, when you go through your teenage years and your early 20s, and you borrow videos from online streaming services and films from online. And it's only borrowing, you know, I don't keep them. But you don't pay for them. And then it's actually funny. It hit me because there was something I used to watch. I don't even remember the name of the show now, but it was canceled after a season because, like, proper viewership was way down. But it was apparently one of the most pirated things ever. And I think something in my head just clicked that day. And I was like, that's partly my fault. So I don't do that anymore. And, you know, whenever I have the chance to support someone who I watch, and, like, I watch all of your videos and I watch all of Shade Resurgence videos, etc. I think it's only right that, you know, you earn something from that, especially now that YouTube doesn't pay much, which I only found out recently just how little it paid.
It's unreal, isn't it? I mean, people go, oh, you know, you must be minted now that you're on YouTube. And you're like, but YouTube is just a vehicle to get the videos out there. I don't pay anything. You know, it's a pittance, you know, absolute pittance.
Yeah, I think it was Suburban Delinquent said at the time, because he pulls wheelies and stuff, I think so many of his are yellow tick marked. He said he's getting $500 a month from YouTube. This is a guy with nearly half a million subscribers. Yeah.
I was going to say, I would love to make $500. God, if I hit 200 a month, I'm doing well.
Yeah, I think I got eight euro in my first month, and I was bloody proud of that.
Yeah.
But if from the Around the World trip, just to get back to that, if you were to do it again, even if you were to go back in time, do it again, would you repeat it on the Gixxer 1000? Or now that you've moved on to something like the GS, do you, like, obviously from an outward perspective, that's a by far more suitable bike. But by the way, I ride stupid bikes as well everywhere. So, you know, you're talking to the right person in that regard. But if you had the knowledge you had now and went back, do you think you'd pick the same bike again?
All I base my choice on riding a bike around is what makes me smile. What do I enjoy riding? And at the time, I loved riding the Gixxer. You know, it was the only bike for me. I genuinely enjoy riding the GS. Maybe it's because I'm fat and old, I don't know. But I genuinely have, on the road, I have way more fun on the likes of the GS and the big adventure bikes than I do on the sports bikes, apart from the S1000RR. That S1000RR is just, you know, I almost bought one. I almost left the GS. And, well, that's how I lost my job. I lost my job in the old build
because of the S1000RR.
Oh, was that it? Was that the one?
That was the one. Yeah, that's the one they complained about. So go and check that vid out.
Yeah, everyone can watch that.
Yeah, it was, it's just a special bike. That bike made me smile and grin the way I used to. Yeah.
And I can't remember, have you ridden the XR, the S1000 XR?
Yeah, I did. I rode that quite a few years ago, and it just left me a bit flat, to be honest. It is fast, but normal, the inline four engines don't really do anything for me anymore. Having just said that about the S1000RR, which tickled my danglies to a whole new level, but normally an inline four just doesn't do anything anymore. Like the twins, the triples, the Vs, that sort of stuff, they do it.
No, I agree.
Oh, so I thought you were going to say something.
No.
Yeah, going back to your question there then, would I do it? Would I do it on a Jigsaw? I probably wouldn't do it on a Jigsaw, but I would certainly contemplate doing it on the S1000RR. Because if somebody said to me, part of the reason I did it on the Jigsaw was because people said you can't do it on that bike. So I thought, well, you know, forget you. I'm going to do it then because I'm quite stubborn like that. So I think maybe if I had that same drive, I would have no qualms about jumping on an S1000RR. Same as, you know, I'd have no qualms about jumping on a C90, or I've got a thing in my head about doing it on an electric bike at the moment. So, you know, if I can make that happen, I'll do it on an electric bike for sure. So,
you know, that'd be cool.
Yeah.
I mean, to do a trip like that, it's a massive investment financially. It's a massive investment mentally, emotionally. You know, it's a big chunk of your life that you're going to have to devote to that trip. So, you've got to make it worth your while. You know, you've got to have a grin factor in whatever you take.
Yeah, of course.
And it doesn't need to be the most comfortable. It's just you've got to have a connection with whatever bike you take.
And it's funny because I think the whole thing you said about people saying you can't do it. I'm 6'7", so you know a lot of people think I can't ride.
I knew you were tall. I didn't know you were that tall. Wow.
Yeah, it's funny because whenever people meet me in real life, they're like, "Whoa, you're a lot bigger than I thought." I'm like, "Yeah, sorry." But it's actually funny since I shaved the head for lockdown. I've noticed little old ladies in the supermarket. I'm a friendly fella. But little old ladies who are there, you know, if I stand behind them, and obviously the 2 meters distance, and I see they're all like, "Oh God, he's gonna eat us." No, I haven't eaten people in years. You're fine.
Yeah, no, I'm still full from the last one.
But the I have a 1987 Honda Magna V4, mm-hmm. and I completely agree with you around the inline fours, and then something that just has a complete different character to it.
Yeah.
And like that bike. It's probably too small for me, but I'm never going to sell it and I'm going to make it fit me. And I also have a thing in my head that I want to do 1,000 miles in 24 hours on that 1987 around Ireland for some charity. I have a couple of charities in my head, but I won't get into that now. But yeah, I understand completely where you're coming from with the Jigsaw 1000. Mm-hmm. It's like, no, I am going to do it, you know?
Yeah, go for it.
But where, and I have in my head where I think my favorite place where you were in the round the world trip was, but where was your favorite place if you had to pick one?
If I had to pick one place, what, to go back and ride, or just for the people and the scenery or everything?
Go both, sir. You can have one of each.
Okay. I think best roads. Honestly, for me, this is really boring, but for me, best roads to ride out there, probably Spain. Just for riding, just Spain. But if you want scenery, people, and riding, it would be somewhere like either Norway or Japan, I would say.
I was hoping you'd say Japan. Japan is my favorite place where I it looks stunning. Yeah. But it's funny. I went out to Spain it's 3 years ago now, and I was in a car with my girlfriend, and it was over around Tarragona, so Tortosa. We went to Miravet, which is an ancient Templar castle. Right. That's where the rally is. You know, we drove some of the roads where the Tarragona rally is. And obviously, I've seen your videos, Picos, and a lot of other people's videos, Picos, and that just looks incredible. But yeah, the roads there are so good.
Yeah,
I mean the whole country rides a bike anyway. It's a very pro motorbike country, but the roads are like, you know, you come over here and the people who design the roads here, obviously the enjoyment of either driving or riding a motorbike it's just not on the planning schedule, is it? It's just not taken into account because it'll generally be the fastest or smoothest point between two points, whereas you go to Spain and it's like whoever designs racetracks designs the normal roads. It's just, it's like if you've got point A and you Yeah, you got point A and point B. It's like, well, why just do that? Let's have some fun. Let's you know, they give a pen to an epileptic and a sheet of paper and off they go. It's crazy. I love it. And the roads are just beautifully smooth as well over there.
They're incredible. They're incredible. Oh, I had a Fiat 500 and...
you got on a Fiat 500.
I actually fit all right, believe it or not. And that was a fun little car. But every time it was gutless. You know, if you hit a hill and those bikes just constantly streaming past me, because this was late August. So the weather was perfect. Like, if I had a bike, I would have been the happiest human on the planet. And these bikes are streaming past me. And it's only recently that I got my girlfriend on the back of the bike. And if I just managed it back then, we just would have rented a bike or something. But those roads, I will get over there. I was actually, my plan was this year to get over there, but obviously it's probably not going to happen now. But in the future, definitely. But yeah, no, interesting to hear that Japan or Norway, because I've watched you know, when the Mighty Car Mods guys go to Japan to get cars and stuff. But I wasn't joking when I say I watch a lot of YouTube. And someone, a smaller YouTuber who'll probably be watching this, Web, he went up to Japan as well and rented an Iron 883, which was really cool just seeing it. And there's a couple of others I watched there as well. But it looks like a really beautiful country.
It's stunning. And it's, the people are so nice over there as well. You know, it's just a polite, respectful, beautiful place. It really is. Yeah, it's a special place, that.
And it's the birthplace of a lot of the bikes we know and love, so
you
know,
have
to apply some reverence to that.
and the place, the whole country has got, you know, it takes history and tradition to a whole new level. Like over here, if we see a building that's 1,000 years old, you know, like Westminster Hall or something, it goes back to, I think, 900 or 1,000 or something, you know, where Parliament is now. The main hall, I think, is like 900 or 1,000 years old. You go to Japan and they've got temples there that are 3,000 to 5,000 years old. And you're like, oh, shit the bed, this takes it back a bit, you know.
And Japanese history is amazing, but I think it's as well, it's because... We probably shouldn't get into history, but anyway, we're going to get into it. That's what podcasts are about, right?
Yeah.
Like with here, you know, we have a lot of churches, obviously, but most people's houses for a long time were, you know, made of mud and thatched roofs and stuff. So they're all gone.
Yeah.
So, over there, and it's even, as you said, it's what they apply to it. Like they really are good caretakers of their history. Mm-hmm. And maintaining stuff like that. So I think even that's awesome to see it. And if you ever, do see any of my videos pop up, I really like to go to historical sites. Like that's one of the things I do in Ireland. And you know, even when I was in Spain, one of the main places I wanted to go was to that place, Miravet. It's literally right. If you ever get to look it up, Miravet, it's a massive castle on the top of a cliff face that overlooks, you know, the meeting point of a river. So these guys had like the view of everything, and they were on a cliff. It's insane. I mean, they were like, hey, who's going to get us up here?
Yeah, come and have a go if you think you're mad enough. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, then people turned up with cannons, you know, and when cannons became a thing, you know, they were probably like, shit.
Yeah. This wasn't in the rule book. Yeah.
What do I have down here next? If we already got onto full-time YouTube a little bit, but just to jump back to it, What? Obviously, we know what kind of spurred that decision a little bit. But how are you finding it? Is it something that you feel that has allowed you to focus on it more and improved your content? Because from an outward perspective, it definitely has.
Well, that's nice to hear. Thank you. I find. I mean, I'm obviously not the quickest editor in the world, because video, like my content predominantly is all trip focused. It tends to be all about trips, and they are, I don't particularly enjoy editing them, I've got to be honest. I like the last stages once you've, maybe it's just the way I edit, but when I edit, I take all my footage from that day so I can end up with, you know, because I've got loads of cameras and drones and phone and other people that come away, I take all their footage. So you end up with like 5 or 6 cameras and drones, maybe 6 to 8 hours worth of footage. I put all that onto a timeline, sync it all up. So I end up with like 4 to 8 hours of footage. And then I have to go through that and cut it right down to, used to be like 40 odd minutes. Now it's like, I try to get them down to about 20, 25 minutes. But that just in itself takes me 3 to 5 sort of 12 to 15, 16 hour days just to get that. Just down to like, say, 20 minutes worth of footage that I can then start properly editing. And once it's at that little 20 minute chunk, that's the bit that I enjoy, when you can start, you know, color correcting and doing the sound and putting the graphics in and really, you know, working out what story you're going to tell and pulling things together. I enjoy that bit, but the first bit I really don't enjoy. But
I understand completely with that. I'm very slow at editing as well.
Yeah, I definitely need to speed up. It's crazy because the trip vids, my core little community that I have seem to really enjoy them, but the trip vids don't attract many new subscribers, you know, because I think a lot of people, they either see that thumbnail come up and go, oh, I'm not interested, yeah, it's another Pyrenees vid, or I'm just not interested, or they'll see it's 25, 35 minutes long, oh, I'm not interested in that. Whereas if you do a review vid, that brings loads of people in. So the review vids bring loads of subscribers, and they're really easy to do. You know, a review vid could take me anywhere from 2 hours to maybe, you know, maybe a day's full editing, and bosh, it's nice and easy, it's done. So I really should do a lot more of them.
Yeah, so, it's funny because, do you enjoy shooting the reviews? Like, as much as you enjoy doing the trip, say?
I've been very lucky that there's not many bikes that I've, because I've chosen to take a bike out to review it. It's not like someone's forced a bike on me. I've chosen to do it. So I generally have some sort of vested interest in it. I want to see what the bike's like, or like the look of it, or something like that. So straight away, I love riding a bike, so I'm having a great time. I'm just riding a bike. But I've generally got something in my head about how I want this vid to go, you know, where I'm going. In my head, I might know beforehand where I'm going to stop and do the beauty shots and, you know, all that sort of stuff. So, or I just make it up on as I go. But I do enjoy it because the beauty of editing is it allows you to tell whatever story you choose to tell, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely, yeah.
The amount of times I've finished a shoot, what a poncy prick. I've finished recording for the day and I think to myself, oh, this is going to be dog shit, you know, oh God, that content's crap. And then once you get back to the computer and you start cutting through it, you think, oh my God, I can make something of this. And then the ones I really enjoy are the ones when you've finished it and you think, Jesus, I quite enjoy that. That's quite a good giggle. And at the time I didn't think it was going to be as good as maybe how it turns out, you know?
Mm, yeah, absolutely. So, absolutely. Yeah. I'm the same, like with the, it's funny that you say about the trips, because I'm like literally there's some people who subscribe to who only watch my trips, and you know, every time I put up one, they're like, oh, I was waiting for another trip video for ages, you know, thanks for doing one, whatever, and they don't have any interest any of the rest of them.
No,
but as you said, they don't pull in, like analytically they don't pull in any subscribers, you know. No. But they get really good watch time, because the people who watch them are the ones who are like, oh, I'm only here for that. Yeah. But then, you know, you do a review on, like, I did a review on my HJC helmet, which I did really want to do, and there was a couple of people who had asked me to do it. But that's, like, for me, which I think I've, what, 1,200 and something subscribers now, that has more views than I have subscribers already. Now, I have two bike reviews that are, like, insane. I don't know why people are watching them, but they are. They've pulled in an insane amount of subs as well, but it's nearly... And I really, I'm the same as you. I just love bikes and I love riding them. But with the trip videos, then I don't know. Do you feel almost nearly disappointed when more people don't see them? Because for me, I went out and, like, for instance, I did Priest's Leap here, which is a mountain pass, and it's stunning. It's just one of the most beautiful places in the world, and it's such a cool road. It's a very slow road, but very cool. And I enjoyed that day out, and I really enjoyed editing it, because I was just looking at these views again, and it tanked. I was like, I'm always disappointed because I'm like, yeah, look, you're looking at my review, but go look at that one. You know, go look, just give it a go.
I've got to be honest, I try not to get too caught up. I mean, he says, I'm saying this, and I've got my YouTube analytics on the screen in front of me here, just because I happen to be looking at it before we called. But I try not to get too caught up in the, or how many views has that got? How many views has that got? I look at my subscriber count a lot, just because I just want to make sure it's still going up, and I'm always on my phone, and I'm always, you know, trying to answer the comments, because I like to think I try to answer as many of the comments as I possibly can. So I'm always on the old YouTube app on my phone, just seeing if there's any comments come in and, you know, replying to them. And I always have a little look at the subscriber thing next to it. So, but as far as the views go, I mean, as long as they're going up, you know, I'm not bothered. My channel's not, I haven't got a lot of views, to be honest. Everyone says that to me, that, you know, I should have. Yeah, I don't know why that is, but my vids don't get particularly high views, but, you know, they get quite a lot of subs for the amount of views that they have. So, you know, those that like it. So I'm happy with that.
I think it genuinely is an optics thing, because, like, for instance, even just like the guys in 44 Teeth, I am still, whatever, like, I am astounded that you don't have more. Like, for me, if you compare your channel to some other channels out there and you're like, how does he have not even 40 and this guy has 150,000? You know what I mean? It doesn't, it comes down to even the lack of effort. Like, it's very clear that you put a lot of effort into your videos, and it's very clear the 44 Teeth guys put a lot of effort into their videos. And they're, yeah, not only that, they're incredibly entertaining people. You're a very entertaining person. Like, how, it doesn't make sense. So the only thing I can think of is it's because of where we're based geographically that YouTube doesn't maybe have pushed to other areas of the world as much as locally. And obviously locally, relatively, we're very, very small pool-wise for motorcyclists.
Mm. I mean, what you're saying there is TMF, Missenden Flyer, Andy, prime example. You know, he's got 150,000 subscribers, and I'm good mates with Andy. And he's always saying to me, he's just like, you know, I cannot understand. Well, he says, I do know why you've not got the views that you should have. And he says, it's because you don't do review vids. Because if you look at Andy, he was churning out 3 to 5 videos a week for about 2 or 3 years constantly when he went full time. And they were pretty much always reviews. And he said, reviews are easy, doesn't take him long. He generally only has one camera. It's not even like he uses lots of different cameras for, you know, to sync in shots. He just has one camera, and he churns out videos, and he just churns them out. He's the first one to say himself, he doesn't put much work in as far as post-editing goes. I mean, his work ethic to film the content is phenomenal. You know, I've got a real appreciation for how much that bloke works now, and he puts the graft in. But as far as editing goes, you know, he'll say himself, he's not a great editor, he doesn't put much work in as far as that goes, and the review vids just bring in loads of views, and that's how he grew. So if you want to grow, do loads of review vids.
Yeah, I like, a lot of people have said that to me as well, and it's actually funny because, you know, I'm on Shade Tree Surgeon's Discord as part of his patron. It was actually him who originally said to me ages ago now when I started that, he was like, just at minimum do 2 videos a week. And I'm not kidding, yeah, you, I started doing 2 videos a week, and on analytics, you know, that little curve just went,
yeah, yeah.
I was like, oh, okay. But yeah, for me at the moment anyway, 2 videos a week even is like, it's a lot of time. And maybe you might feel the same. Do you feel that because you started making videos a lot and putting effort into them, it's made me really appreciate how much work other YouTubers put in?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I look at the likes of, I love the vlogging. I've got to be honest, I don't watch many motovlog type channels. I love the likes of Peter McKinnon, Casey Neistat, Matty Hapoja, do you know Gene Nagata, Potato Jet?
Potato Jet, iPhone,
all those guys. I watch their channels and I look like Peter McKinnon. I mean, the bloke is, I mean, he puts Casey Neistat, he doesn't put Casey Neistat to shame, but he takes it to a whole new level, doesn't he? You know, and I look at their production quality and just think, wow, to churn out videos as frequently as they do. They've got editors and everything on board now, but they didn't. You know, a year, 2 years ago, Peter McKinnon didn't. He started around about the same time I did. He was about 8 months after me when I started the end of 2016. He started sort of early 2017, I think. And we roughly had the same sort of subscriber count for about 6 months. And then all of a sudden, his just went woof, and they've never stopped. You know, it's just exponentially, it's just shot through the roof. But his content is phenomenal.
It is. Wow. It is, absolutely.
I look at it and just think, how have you done that? And as quick as you've done it, how? You know.
Yeah. I think it is a bit of the whole, you know, rolling sticky ball. It gathers momentum the more it grows. It is what it seems to be anyway. So, you know, because you see guys who hit milestones, like for instance, again, Shaytree, you know, I've been watching him a long, long time, and he hit the 100,000, and then, wow, then all of a sudden he's at 150,000. I mean, to me, that seemed like a very short period of time, and it just seems to gather momentum. So hopefully, I would hope that, you know, the more the likes of yourself grows, that, you know, just the more and more momentum you gather, and because you do deserve more, to be fair.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. Thanks very much.
No, and it's genuine. You do deserve more. And you're probably sick of hearing it, but
no. I mean, it's honestly, it's that sort of, no, narcissistic's the wrong word, but it's nice, isn't it, to hear people enjoy what you do. It's nice to hear that, because you think, oh well, it's, you know, it's worth the effort and the time to produce the videos and the content if people are getting something from it. So yeah, thank you. I appreciate that.
And it's funny because I only just shot a video 2 days ago on the way home. It's not made yet, but I someone had asked me about, you know, is it worth it doing motor vlogging? And like for me, the answer was yes. And one of the big things, and it is like I reply to all of my comments, except I think I actually went back and counted after that video. I think three, because they didn't deserve to be replied to. And you know the type I'm talking about.
Yeah.
But just people being a bit ignorant. But it is very gratifying when someone comments something and it's very clear that they've watched your video, they've appreciated Absolutely. The story you tried to tell, and they've responded to it. So it is.
And there's nothing more infuriating than somebody asking you a question when the answer is in the video, because you're like, you plainly haven't watched the bloody video, have you? You know, or I got one the other day.
Sorry, go on.
So, you know, it's like, you must get this. You post a video. Say you post a video that's 15, 20 minutes long. So you post it, you make it public, and within a minute, 2 minutes, someone goes, oh, it's an awesome video, it's a great video. And you're like, thank you, but you haven't watched it, have you?
Yeah. And that's all you can say. Like, you can just say thanks. Yeah. You know, like, you're still taking the effort to comment, but it's like,
exactly. Yeah, but you're like,
oh. You haven't watched it, have you? Because then you know your analytics will tank because someone's just clicked off, and gone.
Yep. Oh, I know that feeling big time. But it was funny because there was a comment I only got two days ago, and I laughed when I got it. Right, it's a review of my 1987 Magna, and like the first thing I talk about in my reviews, because I'm a big guy, and you know, people who have come to the reviews have come there because I advertise them as tall person reviews. Actually, one of the things that drove me to YouTube originally is I was looking for reviews for tall people and bikes, and there are none, or very few. And his question, all he commented was, is it comfortable? And I was like, literally the first section I cover, like I'm talking 2 minutes in, is how comfortable it is or not, you know? And it's like, come on, man.
Yeah. Can't even be bothered to watch it. Yeah.
It's like, oh, he clearly knows, but I'm just going to ask him and he can tell me, because I'm not watching his video. It's like,
yeah.
People are people, aren't they, you know?
Yeah, it is what it is. You got to take the good at the bad.
Absolutely, because you get that sort of, it's not even a mentality, because I honestly don't think people mean any malice by it. It's just, you know, it's just people are busy. People have got things to do, haven't they? They're like, well, I'm looking for this. This person plainly knows the answer. I'll ask them a question. I can get on with my other stuff. And then you've got other people who meticulously will watch from the very start. Because sometimes I chuck in little bloopers right at the very end of my vids.
Some people plainly watch that.
And they, thank you. And they'll watch all the way to the end, and you're like, oh my God, thanks. You literally have gone the full hog through the whole video. So
yeah, you do basically. I do an outro crew thing, and it's funny because I did my 1,000 subscriber giveaway video, and I did an outro crew extra giveaway. So I gave out two things in the main video, and then I was like an outro crew giveaway at the very end, extra. And I mean, I expected like, you know, maybe 5 people to respond to that. At a push 10, I think I got like 30 something people. I was like, whoa,
awesome.
That's really good. I was delighted with that, genuinely.
Yeah,
but honestly, that's mega. I'd be chuffed with that. That is mega. That's really good going. Yeah, nice one.
So that was good. But 100%. And it's funny because I think, you know, like you were saying, you know, people don't mean any malice by it. It's very important that, because anyone who's going to do YouTube, you're going to get negative comments. I think that's part and parcel of it. You know what I mean? And it's very important that you don't focus in on them, because it's a story I do tell when people ask me about the whole YouTube thing is look, I love Jason Tuohill's channel. Openly say that. I think it's a fantastic channel. I really like his content, and the work and videography he puts in is incredible. But, and it was fairly recently, I commented on one of his bike videos and said, you know, brilliant bike or whatever else. And someone commented a really negative comment just under my one. And I genuinely meant like that. I think it was for the Ducati. I was like, that bike is incredible. You know, it's wow. And someone commented under it anyway. And just, it was an unpleasant comment. And he came in and he replied to the guy who'd replied to me and didn't even acknowledge my comment. It's like, come on.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Give me something.
You're taking the time to reply to the super negative dude who personally I would just ignore. You know, reply to the people who are actually watching your video and being like, oh, I like it. But anyway, that's just an observation for me. I think you need to focus on the good stuff.
Yeah, definitely.
So now something that I'm very interested in as well, your time as a police officer. So I know we had a chat about this before we started recording, but to start off, you know, and feel free to tell that story however you like, mm-hmm. it is your story, but is there anything that you really miss from being a police officer to now?
Oh yeah, definitely. And especially at times like, well, times like this, you know, like I think the vast majority of people join the old bill, not because they're power hungry, not because they're assholes. You know, it's nothing like that. There are people like that, definitely, in the job, but they're few and far between. They really are. I have met some amazing people in that job, and I miss the crack, because the crack you get there is unlike most other places. You know, it's like being around a rugby team 24/7, but with a load of toys, and you find yourself in some just insane situations at times. And I've worked with a lot of ex-military, and the ex-military have all said the same. You know, it's that mentality, it's that sort of psyche that people have. It's a perverse sense of humour, it's a sick sense of humour. It's sort of you against everything else that's out there, and I miss that. And when things like this happen that we're going through at the moment, and when the riots happened, and that's why you join the old bill is to be there at those sort of times to do your thing, to do your bit. Same reason I think people would probably join the military or the fire service, there'd be a paramedic or a nurse or anyway, get into the health service. You want to do your thing, you know, it sounds corny, but that's why you do it. It's, you know, like for me, some of the best memories I've got, somebody gets their house broken into or, you know, a loved one's heart or something like that. It's down to you. It's down to you to deliver some sort of service, and you're that person that they are looking for in their time of need. You know, and I relished that opportunity and that responsibility. I really did enjoy being put in that position a lot of the time, you know, where you are that one that's there to try and sort out this issue. And it's an adrenaline rush. You know, it's the biggest adrenaline rush you're ever going to have. Driving or riding somewhere with the woo-woos going as well. You know, it's amazing. 18 years and I would still be grinning like a fat kid in a sweet shop when I put the woo-woos on it and got to drive somewhere with the sirens on. It's, you know, it was a great job, but things change. And I didn't outgrow the job. The job just changed. The sort of politics that were there just changed, and I'd had enough. I'd had enough biting my tongue all the time, and I'd done my bit. Time to move on.
Yeah, and even to comment on it first, I think the what you described there, like with the, it's funny. It's nearly like a family, and even like, look, I'm only an engineer, but I work in medical devices, which has projects that are high stress for us, say, you know, because you have your timelines. And at the time, it seems like the most important thing in the world, when it's not, you know. But, you know, those parts still do help people. But those people, realistically, the ones I make aren't directly saving someone from dying at any point in time, except the custom bits. But anyway, we won't get into that. But I think from the high pressure projects we do, the people you work with in that, they're, you know, they become very close friends very quickly because... Yeah. You know, you're spending a lot of time with them and it's very high pressure. So it's like you said, it's cracking jokes. It's keeping the mood light. So I think that's, yeah, that makes sense that you'd miss that. And I used to play a lot of rugby and I do miss the whole team aspect of it as well. But just to jump on to, you know, the job changed, I honestly, and I know I said this again, but just to reiterate it, When you talked about it with the 44 Teeth guys in the podcast, like I was listening to it at work, and I actually stopped what I was doing because I was so annoyed for you. You know, that's how it went down, because like, Christ almighty, I know you said you were there in a previous video, you know, 18, 19 years, whatever. And just, I tried to imagine myself being somewhere in a job for that long and having that thrown at me. I'd be like, I would be furious.
I was quite annoyed at the, and I still am to an extent, annoyed at the inspector who made the decision. You know, she made that decision that she ordered me to stop all of this, all the teapot, all my online thing. Doesn't matter if I change the name from Teapot One to someone else. She basically ordered me to stop everything online because everyone knew I was a copper, and no matter what name I used online, people would know that I was a police officer, and therefore I represented the Met. And I could understand the line that she was coming from, but she was totally wrong, because the overwhelming message I got from tens of thousands of people, messages that were coming in, it was phenomenal. Thank you, by the way, to if you were one of them that sent me the messages. But the vast majority of people were saying, you know, you portray, or me, I portrayed a very positive role model for the old Bill in the biking community. And that was her main concern, was that I was a negative influence or negative impacting factor on the Met Police's reputation within the biking community. And it was just like, you've got the total wrong end of the stick here. However, you know, she's done me a favour, because it made me make a decision that I've been thinking about doing for a long, long time, if truth be known. You know, like, even before I went away on my trip, I was a little bit sort of delusioned with the job and what I was doing, and I was just like, is this it? You know, is this what my life's going to be about from now on? You know, I was having a proper midlife crisis, I think. So, and then once I came back from the round the world trip, it changes you. It does change you, and I definitely changed as a person. And I just didn't feel like I was on the course I wanted to be on in life anymore. So it's made me make that leap of faith. And apart from this little blip with coronavirus, which we'll get through, you know, of course it will, yeah. And I'm having the time of my life. I'm loving it, you know. Money isn't everything. You know, you've got to pay bills, but I get up in the morning and I'm really looking forward to the day ahead, and you know, it's I'm in charge of what I do now, so I'm loving it.
Excellent. And it's funny because I actually was talking again to my girlfriend about this, that you'd gone full time and everything else, and I mean, I'd be lying if I didn't say, like, I think everyone who does it and puts a certain level of effort into it, they obviously enjoy it a lot. And for me, I'd love to follow in those footsteps one day, because it is, I only get to do a proper trip video at the moment, obviously never, but even before that, it was, you know, maybe once, twice a month because of other commitments and whatever else.
Yeah.
But at those days, you know, I really, really look forward to getting up, going out for the day, taking my time, taking some photos, getting your video, getting home, taking it all down, looking at, you know, that. And you get to do that, you know, all the time. So hats off to you, but I'm also really jealous.
I was too. And, you know, it's, I don't write my own checks by any stretch of the imagination. You know, you still have to pay for a lot of your own things, but the contacts and the doors are a little bit easier to open and knock on now once you start reaching a certain level. And don't forget, you know, the channel's 9 years old, and I spent 3 years planning my round the world trip before that. So you're talking 12 years to build up my sort of reputation I've got within the biking community and within the industry, and also 12 years of building the channel to where it's at. So, you know, it's not an overnight thing. You've got to put the graft in.
Yeah. And that's what I tell anyone who does ask me. It's like,
yeah,
I don't think even for a channel as small as mine, you have to appreciate, if you want to do it and you want to do it to that level, there's so many hours that go into it. And so much crazy money, even for just small cameras and stuff, you know?
Yeah.
It's the worst paid job in the world, even at sort of the level where I'm at the moment. If you look at the hours that you're putting in, I mean, TMF says this. TMF's got 155,000 subscribers. He's doing well each month. Not YouTube well, but he's doing well by a normal wage. And even he says, you know, it's the worst paid job he's ever had, but he loves every second of it.
But that's the difference, isn't it?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. You've got to think ahead, haven't you? You know, I'm at the moment, I'm trying to think to myself, oh, geez, how I've gone from a job where I had a fairly, well, a good pension set up. You know, you put in that 30-odd years of graft, and at the end of it, you get your reasonable pension and, well, good pension compared to most people, and a lump sum and stuff. Well, that's gone now, you know, because 18 years isn't that great a pension in the old bill. It's only the last 5 years where you make up that big amount. So my pension's pretty pitiful. So I'm now thinking, oh crap, I've got to start thinking like a normal person now. Like, what do I do about my pension? So I'm not quite figured that out yet. But, you know, as far as I can see, I'm only ever going to grow. You know, financially, things will only ever improve now because I'm in charge, and I'm that sort of mentality that I'll make it work. If it, you know, whatever I need to do, I'll make it work. So,
and I think you will continue to grow if that means anything. I genuinely, like, looking at your channel and comparing it, I think that whole momentum ball I talked about, I think it will happen for you. Just to pause there, you need to get yourself a can of this. It's bloody delicious. I just cracked it open. Ah, it's so good. Something. It's
Canadian,
so good. Show the other people on the camera. It is so, so good. I just took a sip of it there, and only to see my face, but I was like, whoa, that is so good.
Good. Glad you enjoyed it.
That is lovely. Oh, no, that's it's 6.6% though, so. But just as well to say before we move on from it, I think my comment was very much around the fact that you are, for me, right, I've had family had certain negative experiences with certain Gardaí over here, and obviously a lot of positive experiences as well. It, as you said, it's very much a balance. But for me, looking out on a different country's police force, I thought that you could have no better ambassador than someone like yourself. Do you know what I mean? Down to earth, obviously like the same stuff as I did, which obviously helps. But yeah, definitely, I don't think you could have asked for more if you were to go out and look for someone as an ambassador. So I think they've missed the trick there, but anyway.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I look back, right, and I've had bad days like everybody. All Bill are just people. They're just people at the end of the day, you know. And I've gone into work and I've been in a bad mood right from the start, you know. And I know I can put my hand on my heart and I can look back at certain situations I've dealt with and I've thought, I could have handled that better. You know, I was short-tempered. I was probably too blunt with some people. But then I can also look back and I can think, you know, I'm immensely proud of like death messages, things like that, you know, when people pass away and you have to turn up. It's a horrible part of the job. But perversely, it's something I certainly would take a little bit of pride in, because how you do your job will fundamentally impact on that person's life for the rest of their life. They're going to remember when they found out that horrible news, you know. So it's one of those jobs where, yeah, there's times when I could have done it better, and there's other times where you think, yeah, I've earned my money, I've enjoyed that. Well, not enjoyed that, but,
you know, I've done
it's
my
it's
thing.
Made, yeah, exactly. Well, I think that's actually, obviously, look, I've never spoken to someone who worked in that capacity before, but that's really... It's very interesting, and it's also nice to hear that, you know, that you approach it in that manner, because like you said, that's something that's stamped in that person's memory, I think, forever. How would you deliver that?
Yeah, absolutely.
So no, that's a very interesting one.
Yeah, and we get quite blasé, you know, in the old Bill, in the emergency service, fire brigade and ambulance as well. They're exactly the same, nurses and stuff. We get quite blasé because we deal with these. I'm saying we. I'm not in it anymore. But you deal with those. You know, it's a matter of course. Certainly if you work in a big city, you know, certainly in London, you deal with shootings and stabbings and domestic violence and murders and serious assault. You deal with that umpteen times a day, every day. You wouldn't believe the amount of shootings and stabbings that are going on in the streets of London, and it just never makes the news. So you become a bit blasé about it, you know, and when you turn up and you're dealing with something, it's just like, oh, all right, so someone's just been shot here and, you know, the brains are oozing down in the pavement and you're just, all right, I'll deal with that, right, got to go and do this, go and do that. And when you turn up and speak to somebody about it, what's going on, to them it's some massive, massive incident, you know, it's a huge thing. Whereas to you, it's just like, oh, Jesus, I've got all this paperwork, how am I going to deal with that? And then I've got this to do and I've got that to do. And I think we are very guilty of perhaps taking the human aspect out of some of the things that you deal with in that job. And to a bystander, it can look like you're really cold and, you know, you're unprofessional and blah, 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 blah. But if you took everything to heart that you dealt with in that kind of job, if I can swear, you'd be properly fucked up. You have to distance yourself. You have to bring in that sense of humour. It's just part and parcel. It's a coping thing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I 100%. And I think it's like you said, it's a coping mechanism, because again, and it's no comparison at all. I've never witnessed a shooting, thank God. Hope I never have to, or the aftermath of one. But you know, in my job when I was. As an intern for, you know, we get to see live surgeries in order to see how our components impact people and how they go into the body and stuff. And I've been to three. The first one, it was actually funny because we went up when I was in college at the time, and the nurse who was on the station, you know, I was with a girl who was on my college course as well. And she said, it's always the big fellas who pass out. It's like, if you pass out, said, you're going to ruin the whole surgery, just don't pass out, tell me if you're going to pass out. And I was like, well, I actually have passed out and stuff before. I've hypoglycemia, and I was like, but I've eaten today, so I'll be fine, you know. I once passed out in work and headbutted a printer, scared everyone.
But oh, anyway, no.
Well, I'll get to that in a sec.
Was the printer okay?
It was actually, it survived. It's like my head actually hit, it was, you know, like a plotter, like a huge printer, like for planning documents. It had a metal bar, the plotter bar that caught the paper as it went down. So that's what my head hit. On the way down. But yeah, one of the guys who was standing beside me, he said, I was chatting to him at the printer, and it happens like that. Usually I can tell because I'll start slurring my words and feel weak, but this time just didn't. And he said he thought I'd driven a kick the hardest kick he's ever heard into the printer, and he turned around to give out to me, like, what are you doing? And then he just saw me pan out on the ground. Like, but yeah, definitely, even with the surgery. Oh, by the way, the funny part of that other story was the nurse never even looked at the girl beside me, as in, like, girls don't pass out. She passed out. Fully collapsed. I won't lie, the first surgery I was there, I felt very much like I was going to pass, like, borderline panic attack seeing this stuff, and I was like, oh god. So I just closed my eyes like an intelligent person. Like, close your eyes, think of anything. But the second one I went to, I was a lot more prepared for it, and I got to really look at it. And, you know, it's funny because you get to talk to the person before they go under, and, you know, you're chatting to the person who's about to have. And by the way, knee surgery is carpentry. The doctors who do it well are really, really, really incredible. And you know, not to talk up knee components and knee systems, but the parts really do a good job well. But it's funny because you're talking to this person, then they're out. And I mean, when you replace someone's knee with a total knee system, you essentially cut off their leg. Like, there is not much left there. It's brutal. And, you know, you go from having a conversation with this person to watching someone essentially
sever
their leg. And, I mean, by the way, when they're driving home pieces of knees, there's a hammer involved, you know? It's like, because a lot of them are borderline press fits. So you're just like, what is going on? I completely understand the dehumanizing thing that you have to do to cope. Because the first time I didn't do it, the second time and third time, absolutely. That was that person who I'd just been talking to. They weren't the same person when I was watching them being carved open.
Definitely. And it's weird. It's like, God, this conversation's taking a dramatic turn, hasn't it? But like when you deal with death, when you're dealing with dead bodies and stuff, you know, it's just, it's weird because they're not, this sounds horrible. I don't mean it to sound the way it'll probably come out, but they're not human anymore. They're not a person anymore. It's like literally the soul has gone. I mean, I had the same thing when my mum passed away, bless her, you know, and I had to see her. It's just, you know, I'd seen her. Then I missed when she passed away because I had to go and pick my brother up from the airport. And when I came back to the hospice, she'd passed away. And it was just like, it's just an empty vessel there now. And I know that from the previous life as well, and the old Bill. They just don't seem like people anymore because the life's gone. You know, I've become a bit of a hippie now, definitely, and I just think, you know, there's more to it. There's got to be more to it because what makes you goes when you die. You've gone. You know, it's just this empty thing left, isn't there?
Yeah, it is. It's a strange one. It is a strange one. Everything that animates them. Yeah. Actually, to switch gears entirely before we all start crying, the modern bike industry, right? This is something that I talk about a lot in my videos because, as I said, I am a bike head. It's probably my only hobby now since I've destroyed my knees completely from rugby. So yeah, by the way, I know I'm going to need knee replacement, so that's partially why I'm so interested in it. But it's something that I talk about a lot on my videos, and I've actually test rode the Zero SRF and the Zero DS, and I hope to test ride the Zero SRS in the future, and a couple of other bikes.
Yeah, it looks good, that.
Yeah, it does. It looks very good. But it doesn't, it's very hard to secure bikes here to test ride. It's not really something that's done in Ireland.
All right.
But what I have, yeah, they just don't really do test rides. It's a strange one, except Franklin. Shout out to Franklin. They're the guys who get me all the bikes. Excuse me. But something that I was very interested in before Corona happened was how so many more companies were taking risks, like BMW with the R18, massive risk. Harley Davidson with the likes of the Bronx and their Pan America, that's another big risk. It's a complete gear change. You know, you had the electric bike companies coming on, again, risks, and even the Harley Livewire. And I think that's going to affect it. So just what do you think is going to happen with the future of the bike industry from what you ride? Do you think people are going to play it safe with the likes of the GSs and, you know, what the Harleys you've ridden, the bread and butter stuff? Or do you think you're going to still see the innovation?
What, because of COVID, because of Corona? I don't know. See, I'm still not pessimistic, but I know Al and Chris, Al Fagan and Chris from 44 Teeth, they are really quite worried about how this is going to affect the whole biking industry. I don't know. I think I'm more just concentrating on, you know, the next 6 months. Really, I'm not looking ahead into the next 12 months or whatever. And I think as a consumer, I'd imagine my thinking is that there's going to be a lot of deals out there once we're back and dealerships are open, because they're going to want the sales. They're going to have all these units that have not gone, so they're going to have to get them out there, and they're going to want to kickstart that whole part of the economy, you know, the whole part of bike sales, I'd imagine, will go. Well, should be kickstarted, I would have thought, by some good deals. Longer term, I'm trying not to think like negatively about that side of the economy. I'm just trying to think, right, well, we'll get back into it. And as far as what line it takes, I think we've gone through the whole custom and the cafe racer era. That's all. It's going to be there. People are always going to like to fettle and do their thing. But I kind of think the way I see it is you've got two camps now. You've got older fat people like me who, they're your sort of 80s, 90s crowd who were on sports bikes and then got old and fat and had a bit of money, and they've sort of jumping onto the adventure and dual sport market. But then you are starting to see a lot of new blood coming in with the smaller bikes that
were out there, you know, and
the 300s there seems stuff,
and there's a big rise in the female market as well. So you've got all this new blood coming in, and I don't imagine that the new blood is going to want to hang around on the smaller CC bikes forever. I could see, I know a lot of people don't think it, but I could see there might be a bit of a resurgence in the sports bike market, because people, maybe once they've been on the smaller CC bikes, you know, as a biker, most bikers on the horizon is that sports bike, isn't it? The 600s, the 1000s, that's where you want to go for most people. So maybe there might be another little second wave in the sports bike market. I don't know. For me, the big dual sports, the big adventure market, I think that to anyone that's got any experience riding a bike, that seems to be the best way to go, because you're getting sports bike performance within parameters you can use on the road. You know, all that power's low down with the big V-twins and stuff. You've got all that grunt, say sub 100, it will go over 100, but sub 100 mile an hour. You get done doing over 100 mile an hour in this country, and you could effectively be looking at jail. Not just a massive fine, you could be going to jail. So is there any... I'm an advocate of there's a time and a place. You know, I've said it before. I don't think speeding's wrong. I think it's wrong in certain times. Speed doesn't kill. Inappropriate speed kills. And if you ride like a twat and you ride like a twat in the wrong circumstances, then you deserve what you're going to get. But I also think if you've assessed the road ahead and that assessment's right, then what's wrong with making a bit of progress? But you don't need to be doing 140 mile an hour. You know, it's just if you can make a bit of progress, make some progress. And the sort of adventure sport, dual sport market allows you to enjoy the bike. But if anything happens, you've got to put your hand up and you've got to take it on the chin, haven't you?
Absolutely. It's, yeah.
You're never going to win, are you? Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. But it's...
I'm a big advocate in training and in experience. You know, you do your IAM, do your OSPA. You don't need to grow a beard and wear a high vis, but they do. If you take all the bollocks out of it, you know, hello, this is me. If you take all that out of it and just look at what they're teaching you, you can only ever improve as a rider, and you can only ever get safer. And, you know, at the end of the day, that's what we want, don't we?
And it's actually funny that you say that, because it's another point I did pick up in the podcast of 44th, when they asked you about, you know, slowing down after doing the round the world trip and whatever else, you know. And that's something that I have really, really found, because there's a couple of roads near me that you can go fast on, and they're in the middle of nowhere, and you're very unlikely to meet people on them. So they're, in my opinion, that's the time and the place. It really annoys me, actually, when I see people speeding through towns where there's people walking right beside the road, and then they go 20 under out on the open road. I'm like, what are you doing? You know? But anyway, I noticed there that I was actually back there recently, and I have the same bike, by the way. I've had my Fz6 S2 for years. So it's not like the bike has changed, but I did know, and it's something that it's funny, because I'm always kind of looking at my own riding. I have mental problems. I just always think sleep is elusive. But I noticed that I was going consistently slower on that road, and I was like, why? Because the surface was actually better. It was a better day.
Yeah.
You know, it was a perfect day. And I was like, why am I going slower? And it's just when you mentioned that, I was like, you know what? I think, actually, the better a rider is, the more experience they get. I think they become much more aware of their own limits. I know I am. I'm like, well, actually, I wasn't capable of that. And if something had gone wrong, I was in trouble. You know, now I'm riding at the speed I'm capable of.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's not something that I'd really appreciated until I said it in that 44 Teeth podcast, is that I used to think I was more than capable of adapting and reacting to whatever came my way when I was out on the bike at the speeds I used to ride. And then, you know, a couple of things happened and I didn't react either the way or as quick as I thought I would. And so that, you know, that straight away, that has an impact on you, because you start thinking to yourself, oh, geez, you know, you might get away with it 9 times out of 10, but on that 10th time, something happens and you hit something, or you know, you come off the bike and it's just like, oh wow. And when that, I had a nightmare for, you know, in the space of about 2 years, I think I had 3 or 4 crashes, all commuting, and then a pheasant up in the Lake District.
I was just like why
is this continually happening to me? And because the people that I always rode with, they always rode way quicker than I was riding. You know, I was getting progressively slower and slower and slower, yet this was still happening. And I'm like, what is going on? And I don't know. It's just, it's at the stage now where I am a lot slower than I used to be. And like this Pyrenees series that I'm editing at the moment, you know, I was holding my punters that come away with me, I'm holding them up. I never used to hold anyone up. Now I'm holding them up and I have to wave them by like, yeah, just go and enjoy yourself. You know, but I think you just got to ride with what you're comfortable in at the end of the day, haven't you?
Yeah, and that's something that I'm constantly telling. For some reason, there's quite a few learner riders who ask me, maybe because I'm fairly new to riding, I'm only riding 4 or 5 years. But it's something I'm always telling them, is just take it handy and definitely go out on your own, because that's a mistake I made, is I followed people who were faster than me.
Yeah.
You really just start slowly and build it up, rather than what I did, start fast and build it down. You know what I mean? that's where the problems occur. But definitely. All that it's funny when you said it and it just triggered in my head. I was like, yeah, it's 100% right. And it's just funny when you think about it, isn't it? It's just an odd one. But what else I was going to ask actually about the future bike stuff, right? I know you've ridden electric bikes, and you've gotten to ride the Energicas, and I really want to get my hands on one of them, because I was a complete naysayer until I actually rode a Zero. And it's why I kind of put myself into those situations. You know, I've said the same about the BMW R18, and I'd love to ride one because I don't think it's going to work, particularly for tall people. But the Zero, excuse me, is something that I really wanted to get my hands on. And then I rode the DS first, and I loved it. Mm-hmm. I absolutely loved it. And it was funny because
the
I
DSR?
Went the kind of taller one.
Okay.
Fantastic bike. It's nearly like a kind of a dual sport. I loved it. Mm-hmm. And to be honest, if I had money, which I don't, I'd buy one tomorrow. But the DSRF then is just something else. It's a technological wonder. But at the same time, and I know you haven't, what year XR did you ride, S1000 XR?
I think it's about 2018, maybe 17 or 18.
Okay, you've ridden that. It's something that it felt similar to that, because, like you said, there's no, with the stock exhaust, there's no fanfare. But they nearly ride themselves. Like, objectively, and I know it was in the title of my video, that XR is the best bike I've objectively ever ridden. Wow. but I'd still have my Magna over it.
Yeah.
So it's it's the same with the electric bikes. Like, how do you see them going? Because objectively, the SRF is a fantastic bike, but I'd still have my V4 Magna over it.
I think there's no getting away from it. It's the future. No matter how much we kick and scream and stamp our feet, it will be the future. In 10, 15 years, we'll be electric. It'll happen. And I think I'm not worried about that at all. I used to be until I rode one, and it's a different. It's like biking. It's like proper biking, but it's different. You know, I think it's every bit as much fun, if not even more fun. It lacks things. It lacks the sound, but it's a different sound you get. You know, you hear the wind rather than the engine. You hear traffic rather than the engine. It's all that sort of stuff. And the buzz, you know, the grin factor is huge.
Oh, it's the instant. It's the instant response is just phenomenal. Oh,
absolutely.
And yeah, every time.
Yeah, and I had Alex Sharp there from the English Electric Motor Company. I had him on my podcast. Oh, good. I'm glad you enjoyed that. It was interesting chatting to him, and we kind of both came to the conclusion in our own minds that you just have to. I don't know if it ever will get to the stage where you'll be able to just swap petrol for electric. I don't think electric ever will be as convenient as petrol. I really cannot see. I used to think it would be a question of, as soon as they get interchangeable batteries, you know, so you turn up at your fuel station, you take the battery out of your bike, whack it into a charger, pay your money, take another battery out, whack it in. I thought, well, that's the answer. Surely that's the answer. But Alec was saying that there's a whole load of other logistical issues around that, and who's to say that that battery that you take out has been correctly charged, and, you know, are you going to get like for like, quality for quality, and all this sort of stuff. So he seems to be under the impression that will not happen. If that's the case, then it's a different mindset you need to adapt, and that you're not going to be able to do the mileage that you can do on petrol, and you're not going to be able to do that amount of miles in that set time. You're going to have to allow for a longer journey or less miles in that amount of time, because you're going to have recharge periods. And I think once you get over that, once you just get that into your head, okay, well, this is the norm, then there's nothing to worry about with electric. There really isn't.
No, I agree completely. And it's something I said, actually, I refuse to even talk about range now. I refuse to talk about it in the SRF, because the DS I rode first, and I'm really glad I did, because obviously the SRF is the marquee. Honestly, the DS in that short space of time between when I rode them both, it completely changed my mindset because of how good it was. I didn't even want to talk about range in the SRF video, because I think when you're going in to buy something like that, you know what you're getting, you know? And like you said, you know, if you've made the decision to spend €20,000 in our case on an SRF, you know what you're getting. And if at that point range is still an issue for you, then you're buying the wrong bike. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
But then if you look at the models that are coming out this year for 2020, you know, even the Zero hasn't got the same mileage that the Energicas have, but even the Zero was doing, I think, 120, 130 miles of realistic riding on one charge, right up to one of the Energicas was doing nearly 250 miles to a charge. Yeah, but it had gone from a 20-minute recharge on the Fast DC to a 40-minute. So, you know, 40 minutes is quite a considerable time, but if you've just ridden 200 odd miles, you know, you're going to need a little break there. 40 minutes, stop, have a coffee, especially if it's on twisty roads. 200 miles on twisty mountain roads in Spain, that's a day's riding, you know. People think, bugger off, I'll do 200 miles in a couple of hours. Not on proper twisty roads, you won't.
Yeah, and it's funny, actually, it's something that, you know, there's quite a few Americans actually watch my channel, which is great. Hello, by the way. They're always kind of astounded when I say, oh, you know, I do a lot of riding and I ride all year round. but I have 50,000 kilometers on my phaser. I don't think people understand and respect. Like, I live in Cork at the moment, and there's not many main roads down here. And where I like to go is out West Cork and Kerry, which is just twisty, slow roads. Yeah. As you said, 200 miles on a day out in those roads, that's a long time.
Yeah, certainly is. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
But with the electric side as well, I think it's actually something that might be a really good part of it, is it could bring in the likes of, you know, when you ride out somewhere scenic and there's nothing around you, you know, because you stop, you take a picture, you might have a cigarette of your smoker or whatever else, and you then leave, you know. I think it's going to have a lot of pop-up hospitality places, you know, charge a bike and have a coffee somewhere scenic. And I think that's something that'll be really good, because in Ireland, for instance, out in West Cork and Kerry, there's a lot of places, like small little towns and stuff, that have essentially died because they don't get, you know, no one's looking for that small town fishing spot anymore, anything like that. It's all gone to the cities. But that could bring it back and spread it out a bit more.
Yeah, definitely. People just want to get to their point, their destination at the moment, don't they? But when you start bringing in, as you said, when you start bringing in the necessity to slow it down a little bit, and, you know, your trip for us, say our trip to Birmingham or trip to Manchester, which is 4 or 5 hours from London in the car, you know, all of a sudden you're going to be looking at 6 to 8 hours, because you're going to have to give an hour or two for some recharging, you know. Well, that's a day now, isn't it? It's not just I can go up first thing in the morning and be there by lunch. It's, well, that's a day's journey. So let's plan something around that day. And why would you just sit on the motorway and rinse your battery when you can take the back road and enjoy it? So I hope that is the case, where we can start putting a bit of life back into sort of local businesses and smaller businesses and stuff.
Yeah, I'd love to see that.
It's something that I really hope is a byproduct of this whole COVID thing, the whole Corona thing, is people perhaps, I know a vast majority of people won't, but there will be some people who will start going, well, I want to be a bit more self-reliant, and I want to start, you know, growing my own veg or using the local greengrocers and the local butchers and the local shops, because, you know, when we start putting all our eggs in one basket and relying on that Sainsbury's and the Asda's and the Tesco's and stuff, it only takes one little screw up in that supply chain and that's out the question then, isn't it? Whereas if you're using your... I have some friends that have a farm. Their little farm stall that they have has never been busier because people are now going, poof, we're going there, we're going to use that and we're going to use those products. So I hope it maybe breathes a bit more life into things.
Absolutely, and it's something that's always bothered me, and I think it's been said to me a lot that I was born in the wrong generation. It's actually, I just did a video on that too, actually. What's your favorite era? You know, it's something that I hope comes out of it as well, is like you said, a bit of self-reliance. Like, for now, me, I want in life, I don't want a house, I want my own garage, I want my own space to work on stuff, make things. Yeah. And partially because we had one where, you know, my parents had one when I grew up, but now, like I said, I'm in a shared rented accommodation. Our garden's tiny, couldn't grow stuff here if I wanted to. You know what I mean? So it's something that I hope, even if it comes back to, I know you have it over there, like allotments. We don't really have that here. I'd love to see that come back, because any land that isn't owned for housing is generally owned by farmers, and those farms are getting bigger, which is a pity as well. I like smaller farmers. Right. I'm a bit old fashioned. But yeah, I'd like to see that make a change after all. That'd be cool.
The whole Corona thing, I think, is, it's certainly made me think about how I do stuff. And, you know, I'm lucky enough to have a garden out the back there. And I've said to my wife, it's just like, why the hell aren't we, you know, how easy is it to grow some carrots and tatties and, you know, that sort of stuff? We've got greenhouse out there. Why aren't we using it? Why aren't we just doing something? So at least you have that should the worst happen. Because, you know, it won't take much for the supermarkets to fail. You know, you saw it with the panic buying, didn't you? It's not even a week. Not even a week and shelves are empty. So, you know, it's changed my thinking and my priorities, definitely. Yeah.
Actually, just to on the panic point, it was very funny. I went into our local Aldi. All of the fresh fruit and veg was there. Like all of the processed stuff was gone, and I was like, okay.
Yeah.
And look, I can't cook. I'm a terrible cook. Awful, right? I can get a hunk of meat and I can slow cook it because we have a slow cooker. But I can make soup, thanks, ma'am. So all I did was, you know, I went down and I was like, okay, they've bought everything that I would usually cook. I'll just make soup. So I had lovely soup for a week or two until they restocked everything. And then I went back to normal food. You know, I didn't stick at that. You know, soup, healthy, nah. But
healthy stuff, nah. We don't want that.
Don't want that. The last thing I would like to ask your opinion on bikes, say, and it's something that I like to ask kind of everyone because it always provides an interesting insight. One thing that I'd love to see, and this is, I don't know, maybe it's I'm a very practical engineer, function over form. That's how I was built. Thanks, Dad, for that one. I don't know, should I be thanking him for that one? But anyway, the one thing that stands out to me is bikes have been consistently getting more expensive. Okay, like they have. And even the likes of, and by the way, I don't know, was it ever came across, but I did a video and just mentioned Damon Motorcycles. I don't know if you heard of them. They're doing some incredible stuff. But the likes the electric bikes, I think the electric bikes, and this is something I'd love to see with the current ice powered bikes, is a more modular design. And I think electric bikes are going to lend themselves to that. So basically sell something, frame and a battery, strip down, frame and a battery, and then say, option it out. You know, because a lot of people buy it, like for instance, Harley, and I know you only recently rode one, but everyone who buys a Harley spends so much money changing it up to suit their needs. So something I'd love to see is someone who just sells a frame and a battery because they don't have to go through all their... the one thing that I think stops ice-powered bike companies doing that is the Euro standards. They have to sell something that passes the emissions test and all that stuff. So they have to sell a certain loaded down variant. And Harley do their standard glide thing now, which is great to see, a way cheaper version. But something that electric bikes don't have to deal with because it's a battery and a frame. So why not sell a battery and a frame, you know, have multiple different triple angle options, all that stuff, you know, say, okay, what rake do you want on your bike? Do you want to make this frame a cruiser? Do you want to make this frame a flat tracker? Do you want to make this frame a sports bike? Because technically speaking, you designed the frame right, you could do that. You know what I mean? You can have subframes for your seats. You can have subframes for lots of things. So it's, what would you think of that? And with your way more sway than I have in the industry, is there anyone you could say it to?
You got the wrong idea about me. I'm tiny, tiny little tadpole in this industry. I can see the logic behind it, and you know, and it's the logic behind the whole custom bike market. But that custom bike market is a very small percentage, and I think the money that would be just on listening to what you're saying, my initial thoughts are that the money and logistics behind somebody like, let's just say Honda. Let's just say Honda take on that business model of, right, here's the frame, here's the engine, down to you, what do you want? We have all these different components, pick what you want, design your bike. Fantastic, great, but for them to have all those bits and then to effectively custom build that bike for you, it's not going to be worth the while, I would have thought. It's just that the money would just, the cost of that, the bikes would go from being 15 grand for an expensive bike to 30, 40 grand.
I'm smiling because you walked into my question trap. I'm glad you said that. So,
got it.
A lot of things, you know, coach builders have died. You know, cars used to have coach builders. Again, like I said, I'm fairly old-fashioned with around the automotive stuff. But if Honda, just throwing this out there, right, and I'm more aiming this for the electrical stuff, but if Honda did make an engine and a frame that somehow passed EU emissions and all that testing, just like that, it could see a resurgence of smaller businesses who are essentially coach built, and they say, okay, fine, we'll buy 20 units a year and we'll make them custom. And they'll be relatively affordable in comparison to a completely hand-built custom, because all they're doing is, you know, your triples and your seats and stuff. Yes, it would be more expensive, but it would be an option for someone to get into to a more of a biking business, as in they're buying that power unit and frame, which, let's face it, I've looked into welding my own frame. Frames are bloody hard. and the technology in them is insane. So you have a frame and an engine. Triples are okay. You know, you can get triples machined, custom made up for 300, 400 euro, pounds, whatever, you know, and obviously then getting your stanchions and stuff isn't that expensive. So what would you think of that? Would you like to see even something like that offer just to see would there be an uptake in smaller businesses with the electric? We'll focus on the electric bikes, because you're right, it would be very expensive with the ice powered stuff. But if an electric manufacturer offered frame and battery to smaller companies to do something with.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah, it's a brilliant idea, but it's just, is it a viable, successful business model? I don't know. It's a case of what comes first, chicken or the egg. You know, in order for the big company who supplies the engine and the frame to do that, there has to be a demand from A, the public, and B, there's got to be those little companies out there who are going to take their product and produce that custom bike. And there's not going to be the little company out there to produce that bike until the big companies start offering that. So it's which one goes first? And it's because it's a new thing, money will just go up, prices will just go up. You know, business is business, isn't it? And if someone sees a demand, price goes up.
Yeah, of course. And something I would hope, to be honest, a really good company that I'd like to look at, and it's kind of what originally put me onto the idea. Excuse me. This stuff is delicious but gassy, but genuinely, see can you get a can of it? It's lovely. You know, Mutt Motorcycles. Have you heard of them?
Mutt, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love what they're doing. Absolutely love what they're doing, and that's kind of what gives me that idea. Is, you know, they're putting out these bikes that look so cool, but at the heart of them, they're a very simple engine and a very simple frame. Yeah. But they just add on the extra bits and pieces to make it look cool. So I think that's something I'd love to see with the electric bikes. And the thing that makes it cheap for them to do that is they actually must buy that frame and engine, as far as I know. At least they buy minimum the engine. So I'd love to see Zero or Energica make available their power unit in order for people to you know, do that type of work. Because without that, obviously, look, getting into battery and the case around the battery in order to make it safe is immensely expensive, which is what, obviously, it's why Zeros and Energicas are currently relatively expensive. Now, I don't think they're expensive over 5 years in comparison. They're actually pretty cheap maintenance-wise and stuff and running costs. But I'd love to see them offer that in order for companies who would never in a million years afford the R&D in order to develop that power unit, still make a cool bike.
Yeah. I think there's plainly a booming aftermarket industry waiting to happen, and certainly in terms of electric, same as that you get with internal combustion. There's going to be the same with electric, absolutely, but we just haven't got the core. Yeah, we haven't got the core volume of electric bikes being owned and out there yet. But when that happens, when we make that leap, People are going to want to customize the shit out of whatever they get, aren't they? Doesn't matter if that's electric powered, solar powered, horse powered. Doesn't matter. People will
customize whatever they get.
Yeah, they want to make it.
So better. Yeah, it will happen.
Yeah, of course it'll happen. And bikers, we're notorious for it, aren't we? So that definitely, yeah, it definitely will happen. But it's just, it's the new frontier, really, isn't it? Electric at the moment. It's so young, and every year. I've only been riding electric for, 2 years now? And from the first Zero I took out to the latest Energica that I've had, the development, and even like the new Zeros, I've not had a shot at the new SRS yet, but the development in technology is just leaps and bounds. In 1 year, it's phenomenal.
I said it. Again, in the SRF review, I think, and I can't, someone quoted me on it in Facebook. Someone who at the time I was high-fiving my best friend and my girlfriend. I was like, someone quoted me. I have like 300, 300 subscribers. It's brilliant. But I made a comment in it that, you know, if the likes of Yamaha had made the leap that Zero made, even between the original, you know, SRs and DSs and stuff,
yeah,
if they'd made that technological leap on an R1, in the time frame that Zero made that from the DS to the SRF, yeah, they would be up in lights and everyone would be singing from the rooftops about them. And it's just, it's funny because it's electric and because the interest isn't there yet, it kind of went unnoticed.
Yeah, I mean, electric is still certainly amongst the biking community. Electric is still treated with huge amounts of suspicion. It's treated with, you know, it's the death of biking. Rather than people just embracing it, which they're going to have to do eventually, they're not ready. And I'm not, you know, I'm not ready to give up my petrol bike yet. No way. I would not, as much as I love electric, I would not buy electric over petrol at the moment. I just won't. But I'm very aware of the fact that probably within 5 years I would. So we'll see what happens. And I'm not bothered about it. I'm not fussed about that.
No, and that's what I keep telling people, is to try one, you know? And they will change their mind, because if you like riding bikes, you're going to like riding them. You know, you are. I mean,
the latest Energica, it's got over 200 newton meters of torque. 200 newton meters. You know, that's phenomenal. That's phenomenal. We talk about like a Tuono. The Tuono will rip your spine out of you, and that's got 170 odd brake horsepower on it. This thing's got over 200. It's insane.
I'd love to try.
What's
them.
Not to like?
Yeah, 100%.
Take out the new Energica. What do they call it? Is it the Zero? No, not Zero.
Ego. That's it. Ego. Yeah, that is their, effectively, that's their R1. You know, it's the one that's used in the Moto E series. It's based on the Ego, and I got the opportunity to ride it in Italy, and it's just nuts. And the Energica, it's like a cafe racer style bike. The Energica, it's the power on it is just nuts. It's crazy.
I have to. I literally fly over to the UK when all this is over and see will anyone give me a go on one. By the way, you're really good at leading questions, naturally, you know that, because my next question was going to be, and this is kind of
my interviewing skills from the old Bill.
Yeah. You're good at interviewing. Yourself.
I'll have you confessing soon.
But you kind of already half answered it, but you said, you know, you wouldn't buy an electric bike right now, mm-hmm. but in 5 years, or even now, we'll put it this way, if you had the money right now, would you mm-hmm. get an electric bike as your second bike in your daily commuter, for instance, and in 5 years?
If I had money there for a toy in the garage, something that I could just take out, enjoy and have fun on, I'd get an electric bike, no problem
at all.
I think I'd get the Zero Days tomorrow.
Yeah, I'd have no qualms in owning one at all, and they're a lot of fun. They're great fun, but I wouldn't rely at the moment. I wouldn't rely on it as my, because I don't own a car. I only have my bike. So, you know, my wife has a car, but she uses that. So for me, I have a bike. That's it. And at the moment, I just, for what I like to do on a bike, you know, I like the opportunity to do big miles, to ride wherever I want to ride. You know, if you've got to put in a massive mile day, I'll do that to get somewhere to have fun, you know. And as we discussed, electric restricts the distance and the time that you can do. But as far as the grin factor goes, it's I'm all over it. I love it.
Absolutely. And it's something, just to finish before I go on to letting you finally go home, or well, not
home. Oh, don't
worry about it. But again, it's something that made me a bit introspective when I rode those electric bikes. I was like, because I'm actually writing up a video on a kind of a 5-year comparison between my Fazer, because I have the cost of my Fazer, and an electric bike. And again, right. I've gotten kind of maintenance costs of Franklin, which, again, thanks, Franklin. They're very open and honest about that stuff. But I looked at it and I was like, okay, well, when could I use an electric bike? And when you look at it, it's actually like, I mean, 5 out of 7 days of the week. You know what I mean? So it's the bulk of the time I would happily use an electric bike. It'd be way cheaper, way cheaper, more reliable. Although, in fairness, and fingers crossed, the Fazer has literally never let me down, but technically speaking, more reliable. So I think if people looked at it from a non-emotional perspective, mm-hmm. a lot of people would have an electric bike as, say, their daily 80% of the time bike, and then keep something like your GS or like one of my bikes for
toy.
Fun.
Yeah, a toy to play on.
No, yeah, I totally get that. But biting's an emotive thing, isn't it? It's a passion thing. It's, I think you, I think majority of us out there, we probably ride with our hearts as much as we ride with our brains. And I think we're not there yet. We're not at that stage yet.
We're forced down that road. Yeah.
I think that's what will have to happen. We will have to be forced down that line. But you've got nothing to worry about when that time comes. We'll be kicking and screaming, but I think once you get on one and you try one, you'll realise, oh, this is actually pretty damn good. Yeah.
It's interesting as well. My girlfriend rides horses, and I had this conversation again with her and another friend around, you know, biking and electrics. Because literally people can't shut me up about this stuff generally, and they try. But for instance, with that, you know, the car was seen as the death of the horse.
Absolutely.
Electric cars were seen as the death of petrol cars, and vice versa for bikes. So I think there'll always be a space for enthusiasts, but your 90 percentile who don't want to work on their own bikes, who don't want to tinker in the shed, whatever else, they'll make the move to electric, but there's always going to be petrol bikes there. And that's something that's comforting for me. I'll get to it in a second. But I think we will be forced down that road to move to, if it's not electric, if it's hydrogen or whatever else might crop up, I think we will be forced down that road eventually. But I think for people who are listening to this and going out to cry in the corner with their petrol bike beside them, I don't think it's going to be the end. It'll be the same as horses. You know, it'll be very much an enthusiast's hobby, but they'll still be there.
Of course they will, yeah. I mean, Alec, when I did that podcast with Alec, the English Electric Motor Company, he was saying exactly what you said, and that steam was considered the forefront of technology at one stage. And then we moved into internal combustion, and now you have the steam fairs. And he did exactly the same analogy of you as you did, in that, you know, 10, 20, 30 years, 40 years down the line, We'll be going to the country fairs in our electric vehicles and on our electric bikes, or who knows, even hovercraft. Who knows what's going to be around the corner? But there will be people there, you know, sitting on these engines with flammable fluid, revving the nuts out of them, you know. And those people in those generations will be like, you did what? You used to sit on that bomb. And we'll be sitting there with our knackered knees and backs going, oh, I remember those days. That was great fun, you know.
And you could just be someone who brought along a Gixxer 1000 that went around the world.
Yeah, I know, yeah. It'll probably still be going. You never know.
But that kind of brings me on to sort of, again, something I kind of ask everyone, but it's for a bit of background, right? And I'm allowed to finally reveal this because my reveal video will have been out before I release this. I currently own a 2007 Phaser, like I said, 1987 Honda Magna V4 750, which is by far and away my favorite bike. And I recently took guardianship, is how I'm going to phrase it, because it's my uncle's, but I think I'll be riding it, and I am restoring it. A 1996 Gixxer 750 S-Rad carbed.
Wow.
Yeah.
The wedge at the front? The wedge front?
Original paint. Well, I have a picture of it on my phone. I'll show you. It's the only way I'll be able to show you. one moment. But it is, in my opinion, it's a very, very pretty bike. And it sat in our shed at home for, was it 13 years was the last time it was taxed. And this is the best picture of my phone, cause I'm a knobhead and I take everything on my nice camera. but that's it. That's the color scheme.
Oh, yeah. Got you.
And it currently has the hump back on the back now.
Nice. I like the old S-Rads.
I love it.
I really like the look of them.
And it's funny when you said, you know, everyone aspires to the sports bike. That was in our shed at home because my uncle stopped riding it for minimum 13 years. But I remember when I was younger walking out, looking at it and going, I want that.
Yeah. It's funny. The whole time I ever used to think about riding a motorbike, it was always the Gixxer, the blue and white, and it was the S-Rad style. It was always the blue and white Gixxer that was on my, you know, that was the bike that I wanted. And even once I got into my sort of 20s and I joined the old Bill and there were bikers there that I worked with and I would talk to them about, oh, I always want to ride a bike. What bike should I get? Every single one of them were like, you know, it's a G6R 750. That's the one you want. G6R, G6R. And that was it. I ended up getting one. Yeah.
And you got the 1000. Didn't even go to 750. Wow, yeah, you got the big boy one.
Well, I started with a 600. I had that for about 8 months. And then, I went straight for the 1000, to be honest. Because the 750 is the same physical size as the 600. And the 600 was, you imagine, I'm 6'3", 20 odd stone. It's the 600 was just too small. So I wanted something a little bit bigger, just a smidgen bigger.
750 is very much like this, yeah, 100%. Yeah, well, I'm okay with that. Like I said, I'm too big for everything.
Wow, yeah. Mind you, but the older bikes were bigger than the newer ones anyway.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's actually, I saw the guys, again, the 44 teeth guys, on the CBRRRRRRRRR. And they, like, even Al looked, he looked a big guy in it. And no offense, Al, but he's not a huge man, you know, and he's relatively fit. And he did, he looked a big man on it. It's a very small frame.
Yeah, they are. They are crazy small now. They just are insanely small.
Yeah, but that, I suppose they can make the frame smaller, lighter, stronger. So, you know, that's what it is.
Yeah, and I think certainly the Japanese bikes, you know, they're a small type of person. So they're built, or they used to be built for the Japanese frame. Just the way it is, isn't it? Obviously now you've got your European bikes, but then you look at your racers, a lot of the racers, certainly at the MotoGP level, they're tiny little people, you know. Even Rossi at 6'3", he's still only about like 10-11 stone, you know. They're tiny,
very skinny, yeah. Man, it's actually funny, I went to the MotoGP in Silverstone 2 years ago and it was cancelled because of the rain, the first time in 35 years, by the way. Well done me. But
your fault.
Yeah, I got a paddock pass and I was in walking and Marquez walked past. And I swear to God, you know when you see someone on TV and you kind of like, you blow them up, they're bigger than life. And then he's not a big man. I saw him and I was like, oh, he's tiny.
I know, do you know who is exactly how you expect them to be? Is Colin Edwards. I was really fortunate enough to meet him on my world trip. Just a total fluke that I ended up being at his ranch and meeting him. And he's a normal size bloke. You know, he's a normal size guy, and he is the most down to earth bloke you'll ever meet in your life. He was, you know how they say never meet your heroes? He's one that you can quite happily meet. What a brilliant bloke. Yeah, just awesome. Awesome bloke.
I was just saying, I don't know, do you follow rugby at all, but Brian O'Driscoll, you know, Brian O'Driscoll. I've met him a few times and he's exactly as he seems. The man, he's a gent. Yeah. But yeah, I won't mention the other hero who I've met, who was a complete and utter letdown. I won't, because I actually know his cousin, so it's the case of his cousin. But you know, I met him and I was like, oh, you're an asshole. Oh, okay.
Yeah, there are a few like that. I used to play rugby myself, and I actually, believe it or not, I trialled for Scotland at one stage, but I didn't. I trialled with Jason White, remember the old Scottish captain? I used to play against him at school level, and then we played together at district and representative, and then we both went in trial for Scotland and he got it and I didn't. I ended up at uni with his sister and all sorts, you know, and it's crazy how your worlds sort of intertwine and then just go like that. Total polar opposites, don't they? Next thing I'm watching Jason. Well, you know, I was pretty jealous of him when he was playing British Lions and stuff. You're like, wow. That's pretty special.
It is, absolutely. Yeah. So one question again, and I think I meant to ask this about 10 minutes ago, but if you had the pick of three bikes from any era of biking, any part of history, no matter the cost, in your garage, what would they be?
Oh, wow. Wow.
I don't like to let people prepare for this one because it makes them think.
Yeah. See, I'm new to biking, so I don't really have knowledge or anything like that of older bikes. Mine's all pretty much since sort of 2008, 2009. I'll be really boring and I'll say, as my everyday bike, it would be the new 1250 GS. Sorry. Just because it does absolutely everything almost perfectly, and I can do whatever I like on that bike and not need to worry about it. For shits and giggles, at the moment, I've not ridden it yet, so this is ridiculous to even say it, but the Ducati Street Fighter, the V4 Street Fighter, just looking at that bike gives me stirrings in the loins, and if it's anywhere near as much fun to ride as it looks, that would be my bike. Otherwise, for fun, it would be the Tuono.
The new Tuono.
Yes.
Yeah. I had a 2014 V4 Tuono, and it was immense fun, but it was typically Italian. It was really temperamental. It didn't like cold, it didn't like early starts. It was hot. But when it worked, it was brilliant. Okay, so Tuono V4, the GS, and the S1000RR.
All new bikes.
That's a good stable.
Oh, yeah.
But I mean, there's umpteen others you could pick, isn't there? There's no shit. Yeah, there's, as far as new bikes go, there's no shit new bike. They're all amazing. There's just the bar has been risen to such a level now that to say a bike is bad, any of the new, I cannot think of a bad new bike.
And it's actually not that I've tried anyway.
It's funny because it's something I'd love to do, because a lot of people, and look, I was the same. I was very, very fortunate, and it's something I've often said is my uncle owned my Phaser. I bought that off him. I got an excellent deal on it. Wouldn't have had it otherwise. I wouldn't have had a bike that caliber otherwise. The Gixxer, you know, it's again my uncle's, and the Magna I bought myself last year, right? But at the time when I got the Phaser, I couldn't have afforded a proper bike, especially, you know, you pay in stages. And it's something I'd love to do is, you know, the Benellis.
Mm-hmm.
So like the 500 and something cc Benelli and the new 700 and something cc Benelli, you know, they're done on finance now and they're pretty affordable. And if this channel ever takes off, one thing I want to do is get one of them, buy it myself, do a long-term review on it in order to enable people who were like myself, who could have afforded the weekly payments and something like that, but would never take the risk on it because it's something that, you know, might be, you know, you're not going to take the punt on a lot of the time if you're signing on for X amount of years of finance and it's not a proven bike. I'd love to get one and just test it.
Thank you, Ben. Cheers. Thank you.
Very nice.
Mrs. Teapot, she's a good woman. She's a good woman. Thank you, dear.
I
won't.
I'm trying to decide on her to open this Nightcrawler milk stout.
Oh, wow. Yeah, go for it.
See me try it. Go on, we'll try it.
Why not?
But yeah, it's something I'd love to do is try a bike that, you know, most people, you know, could afford, because I couldn't get something I'd love to have is the MT10 or the MT09. I couldn't afford one if I was. I just couldn't. But like a Benelli, they're a nice bike, you know, they're nice looking. So I think I'd like to test one and see could people realistically buy it.
Yeah, yeah. No, definitely. Yeah, if you're in a position to do it, go for it. But
Just having a little think.
Is it all right? Is this your night crawler? Is that what it's called?
Yeah, the Night Crawler Milk Stout from Old Brother Brewing. It's quite nice. Strange aftertaste, but quite nice.
Wow.
I don't really know what to say on that one. Wow. Bikes. Question on the bikes. When you asked about what would I have in my garage, do you know, now that I've accepted the fact that I'm fat and old and I've actually got on a Harley, I was out riding with the guy that introduced me to Harleys is this chap called Mike Noble. Don't know if you might have seen him when I did the Harley review vid. He's a sales manager over at
the guy who was out at the end of the video.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
And
Mike has his own. He owns a custom build business, so he will custom build Harleys, and he has his own little stable of proper old vintage Harleys there, going back to, I think, the 40s, maybe 50s. But he's got like a proper easy rider chopper Harley with a suicide shift and everything like that. And it looks horrific to ride. It looks like it's going to be temperamental. But I look at that bike and I think, oh yeah, I get it. And I didn't get it till I rode a Harley. And now I'm looking at them and I'm thinking, I would love to have something like that in my stable, just for those, you know, for those beautiful summer days when you're just going out and you're going to cruise. It's just, the Harley totally blew my mind about how enjoyable just being on two wheels can be. Not risking your life, having those near-death experiences when you're like, oh, I can't believe I got round that bend. But just being out and cruising along, and that never used to appeal to me because I like to make progress. Now I was on that, like, that great big bus of a Harley, and I loved every second of it.
So it's funny, isn't it? It is like, yeah. It's something I keep telling people to try is try cruisers, because it is. It's even on the Magna, I'm far more relaxed on it. You're just chilling, you know. Yeah. You're enjoying the wafting. Rather than the goal.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, definitely. So I think I've got about 19 bikes now in my garage, haven't I? But I think there would be a place for a sort of old classic style cruiser, Harley, something like that. I don't know what, but one of them.
Well, I tell you what, if you ever come over to Ireland, I'll let you try the Magna, and I guarantee you, you'll probably want one.
You're on.
One of the most underrated bikes in history. Absolutely. You're more than welcome anytime.
Well, I was coming to Ireland. That was my plan, was to come over to Ireland this year. Because obviously everyone keeps telling me you've got to do the Wild Atlantic Way and do all that sort of stuff. So I was coming to do it, and then obviously Corona dropped its bollocks. So if it disappears and we're allowed to travel again, I'll be over either this year or I'll definitely be over next year. So,
well, when you do, we'll hit me up and you can have a go on that V4 Magna. Absolutely.
Oh, you're on. You're on. Let's do it.
What else do I have here? So we're nearly done. I promise to let you go.
I don't want it. I've got all night. Don't worry about it. Don't worry. I can talk. You've probably figured that out.
Yeah, so can I. I'm Irish. That's apparently one of our hidden talents, or not so hidden talents. But your best biking memory, if you have one in particular you can pick out, because I know there's one that stands out to me in my head. That's why I like to ask people, is there something that burned itself into your mind, you know, that was just a great day or a great spot you went to, or something that you went, I really, you know, this is it. This is for me. This is my thing.
Do you know, there's been so many, even apart from the world trip, but one thing that just sticks in my mind, and the bike is part of that, was the couple of days I spent in Lao, stuck up in the Ho Chi Minh Trail on that road that hadn't been built yet. So I was literally in the mud and the rocks. They'd carved through the mountain where the road was going to be, but they just hadn't built the road yet. And I'm on a jigsaw. And it was the hardest couple of days I've ever spent on a bike, but it's probably one of the most impressionable moments in my life, because, you know, to get through it and to do all that on that bike, it's just burned into my brain now. You know, there's so much that I didn't capture on film because I was utterly fucked. You know, It's like near on 100% humidity, and I'm in a leather suit on a sports bike, and I'm going through mud, I'm going through water. I was having to go up and over rock falls, literally scrambling over rocks, piles of rocks, like 10, 12 foot high piles of rock on a jigsaw. I don't know how it did it, but it did it. And you know, I dropped the bike. I had to pick the bike up. I got held up at gunpoint by a village because they thought I was a bandit. There was just... I slept with pigs. I did all sorts, you know. You might want to pause this bit or mute this bit, but I drank water out of a stream in the mountain next to the road, and 12 hours later I had explosive diarrhea whilst wearing my leathers. I didn't make it out of the leathers, so, you know, it's all different things, you know. It was a horrific yet fantastic couple of days, and that has stayed with me. You know, I think to myself now, you got through that, you'll deal with anything.
Yeah, absolutely. That's brilliant. That's exactly the type of thing I was looking for.
but with biking, you know, with biking,
it's just, for me, it's a social thing. I like to chat. I like to meet people, and biking just. I think if I was in a car, I wouldn't be as inclined to chat with people the way I am on a bike. You know what it's like. You stop at a cafe or a petrol station or side of the road and somebody stops. The bike's a focal point to chat about. People don't chat about, well, they do chat about cars, but I wouldn't. I don't know anything about them. Yeah, exactly. But with bikes, people are, if you don't ride a bike, you're still looking at that thinking, no matter what it is, even if it's a Harley, you're looking at it thinking, that's cool.
That's cool.
Or even at the far end of the spectrum, you're thinking, there's a nutcase. It's still an attention drawer, yeah?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I love the social side of it all. I love that. You know, would I have ever met you? Would I ever be having this conversation if it wasn't for bikes? Probably not. And I love what it opens up to you. It's great.
Oh, and I couldn't agree more. It's funny, and my girlfriend will probably confirm this more than anyone. A lot of people probably wouldn't consider me very social, you know, at all. Because I am very much, and look, this is definitely a failing of me, but I'm very focused on automotive everything. It's all I've ever really had an interest in, you know. I remember we were somewhere, and I can't remember who said it. It could have even been my dad. Someone said, geez, you're so, my dad can talk. Like, he'd talk about anything for Ireland. He'd argue with anyone. You know, he can talk. And someone was like, Jesus, where did he come from? He's very, very quiet. And Dad said, I'll go over and ask him about, you know, a car, a bike. And I was young at the time. They went over, and then he said they came back an hour later going, Jesus. So it is. Yeah. It is. It's funny. And even when I came down to Cork first, you know, again, I'm fine like this. But in a public scenario where there's lots of people, not so good, not so strong in that point. I had pretty much no friends until I started realizing, oh, there's other people in work who have bikes, and now they're some of my best friends. You know what I mean? It's funny. Yeah. And even, yeah, like you said, the whole YouTube thing, I've met, like, from the world already, like the guy I mentioned earlier, Webb, he's Australian. You know, there's another Australian, Hachui. There's multiple people in Australia, America, you know, UK, Scotland, everything. There's so many people I've met who I wouldn't have otherwise met. Even locally in Cork, there's people I wouldn't have met. So yeah, definitely, it's cool.
Yeah. It's just a great, I think it brings out, it's a leveler, isn't it? It's a leveler amongst people, and it brings out the best good qualities in people, I think, bikes. You get dickheads, but you get dickheads everywhere in life, don't you? And I think the people that will take the opportunity and the time to meet and chat with you through bikes generally are really good people.
Absolutely. And even at that, you know, you meet a biker at a petrol station, like you were saying, and they don't want to have a chat. You're always surprised because it's very much the exception, not the rule.
That's GS wankers, isn't it?
Yeah. No, I'm...
Yeah, it's... It's weird, isn't it? It takes all kind of folk, doesn't it? It does take all type of folk, and there's good people, there's bad people, but I think just ultimately most people are really decent, down to earth, normal people. Some people are a little bit more guarded maybe than others for whatever reason, but I think most people are brilliant, and I think biking brings out the good.
Yeah, 100%.
God, that's deep. I've become such a hippie.
But I'd agree with you, and I'm very much a cynical type of person. I agree with you. Even when you see charity fundraisers and stuff for bikes, there's never a question of will we hit the goal of the charity fundraiser. It's always we'll put it up, and you know it just gets
absolutely.
Hit, you know.
Yeah. Straight away, no matter what happens in the world, you look at any of the biking forums or Facebook pages or any social media, somebody straight away, bang, will organise a ride, will do a rally, will do something. People are, like even just now, you know, look at the volunteer riders that are out there all over the UK and Ireland, delivering medical supplies, delivering people's groceries, doing all sorts. Just, can we help? We're there. We'll do it.
It's actually funny because I'm part of the group, the local group in Cork for delivering PPE.
Awesome.
But because I'm still in work there, by the way, they're Bravo Charlie Tango is if you want to get onto them, ppedonations@gmail.ie. But I'll put up the link in down below later.
I think somebody from that messaged me on my Facebook. I did a post or two about them. Mm. Yeah, amazing. Brilliant.
But the interest in that is so much that, and I'm not joking, you're right. I'm pretty quick on my phone because I'm generally on it for YouTube. But a post goes up saying we need a rider to go from here to here, and before I even click in, someone's hit it.
Yeah.
And it's just if it's raining, it's never a question that someone's like, oh well, okay, who's going? It's always there's about 50 volunteers, and someone in work asked me, he's like, oh well, why isn't there a group like that for cars? And I was like, you find me someone who's as willing to jump in their car and spend their own fuel money just to drive somewhere. I was like, it doesn't exist the same. And it doesn't. I'm a car person as well, but I'm more a bike person. If you were to tell me, oh, I need you to drive 200 kilometers to collect this completely meaningless object and drive back
in
again.
The pissing rain.
In your car, I'd be like, nah. But in the bike, I'd be like, yeah, no problem.
Absolutely. Yeah, definitely. No, it's a good little world we have, definitely.
Absolutely. So to finish off, is there any questions you'd like to ask me first off?
Cool, blimey.
Sheesh. What's your first name? I don't even know your first name.
I realise I never told you. Yeah, Michael.
Michael, it's lovely to meet you.
Thank you. It's very nice to meet you as well.
Wow. Well,
all I'm going to say is keep slugging away with the channel because it is a slog. It is a total slog. But, if it's what you want to happen, it will happen. And I've got to admit, I hadn't watched too many of your videos before and you started cropping up on my Instagram, but I have been watching some of them now. And, you will get there. You just got to keep doing it. You've just got to keep chucking the vids out, and it'll happen. And I want to meet up with you. Definitely, I'll come over to Ireland, and we'll do something over there.
Yep, definitely. I have a lot of places you'll enjoy, I think.
is this involved?
Yeah. Hey, if you want some of them, we can organise them. That's not a problem over here. Is there anyone you'd like to give kind of shout outs to or anything before we close off? Can be charities, other channels, people, whatever you want.
Channel wise, I hang around with the likes of TMF and Richie and Lamb Chops and all that. They don't need any shout outs, but it's people like yourself and all the other channels that are out there and coming up in the scene at the moment. Like I said to you, just keep going. Just keep producing content. Get in touch with me if you want to get in touch with me. info@teapot1 or any of the social media. I'll gladly come out and meet as many people as possible. We can do collabs. I think the moto vlogging scene on YouTube now, especially in the UK, there's so many coming out now. It's out there. There's some good ones. There's some shit ones. We have to stick together as a community, don't we? And don't be a dick. Just don't be a dick on a bike. Try and portray the best that we can portray to the general public out there. Because in the UK, we're not held in particularly high regard, I think, by the government, by the media, by the general population. So try not to act like a dickhead, have fun when you can have fun, but screw the nut in the towns and the villages, you know, and all the positives from the biking community that we've just discussed, that is something that we should be promoting hand over fist, I think. Yeah.
I think we're doing our best to do that with the channels anyway.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, absolutely.
And from my point, look, at the end, I always shout out people on podcasts who've sent me, you know, stickers or whatever else. At the moment, I don't actually have any new ones, partially because of COVID. I know someone has sent stickers to me, but they haven't got here yet, so I shall wait. But just on that, you know, the usual, if you watch these videos, there's plenty of people out there who I highly recommend. The likes of Webb, who probably is one of my favorite channels on YouTube, WEB, if anyone's looking for him. You know, Hatchu, everyone who's appeared on the podcast, and someone who will be appearing, two guys who will be appearing on the podcast after this one who've already agreed to it, Grom Trooper and Slow Ride CA, two good guys. And honestly, and again, thanks to you as well. It's actually you give up a lot of time to come on these, you know, out of your evening, and I do massively appreciate it. So thanks very much, Bruce, for coming on.
Well, I'll tell you what, Michael, it's a real hardship to sit and talk bollocks for a few hours drinking beer. No, mate, my absolute pleasure.
Ah, thanks very much. And obviously, look, if you ever want to come on and talk poop again about anything, let me know. No problem. I'd do these loads. So yeah, look, as I said, thank you very much for coming on. I really, 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 really do appreciate it. And
pleasure.
For the couple of people who I said it to, this isn't like a. I think I said it to you. It's not a subs grab or anything. I just love talking to other bikers, and obviously it's kind of like, I think it's a, you're a victim of your success in that I've watched you a long time, I've watched other people a long time, so I'm always going to be naturally interested to talk to the people who I've watched for a long time. So yeah, it's just pure interest, so I hope that came across as well.
Oh man, it's just been genuine. I've just enjoyed it. It's been a good chat. It's just been a normal, it's like I've known you forever and we're just chatting down the pub. That's what I love about these podcasts. It's just conversation, isn't it? Yeah, definitely.
Actually, before we go on, one last question. I'm a devil for questions, right? But you just mentioned it there. Do you find it weird when, you know, someone who's watched you for 5 years or whatever else, and they feel like they probably know you, like whatever else, like a good old friend,
yeah,
and they come up and they're like, oh, how are you getting on, you know, it's,
and you don't even know their name.
yeah, exactly. Do you find that weird, or is it just kind of like, okay, roll with it?
I used to feel quite guilty and bad, because I'd be like, well, they know me, I don't know you. It's like, oh no, what, why don't I know you, you know? It's like when you go to a party and someone comes up and starts chatting to you, and oh, how you doing, I've not seen you since such, and you're thinking, shit, I can't remember meeting you. It's a little bit like that, isn't it? But now I just now it's almost like, well, the name side of it doesn't really matter anymore, does it? It's just, if someone's invested that time to watch your content and your channel, and they know all this stuff about you, to me, I just take it as a massive privilege that I've had that sort of impact on them, that they've chosen to spend some time with me virtually through the videos and stuff. So I'm just appreciative, really, of people coming up and saying hello. I love it.
Very good.
Like I said, I'm a hippie now.
It was a slow transition, but you got there.
Yeah, God, yeah.
Yeah, you went from being a Gixxer rider. In fairness, you did wear your gear. You're a Gixxer rider who wore your gear, fair play. Now you're a GS rider. So yeah, a hippie GS rider of all things. Next, you'll have to get
I don't wear a high-vis jacket. I don't wear the high-vis jacket.
I don't do that, though. Yeah, don't ever go that far. Or the polite jackets.
That's a penalty. I've got a touring little plug here. On my touring business, Chicken Strips, when you come away with me, we have a daily fine. So if you screw up the day before, every morning at breakfast, we have a kangaroo court, and they nominate in the kangaroo court a person to wear the polite vest. So every day someone gets the polite vest to wear. And then you have to sign it at the end of the day.
But look, I'm going to stop recording soon, so I will just say to everyone, if you watch, thank you very much for watching. If for some strange reason you have not yet found and subscribed to Teapot One, please go check him out, watch his videos, subscribe. Yeah, if you're here and you're enjoying my videos, you'll definitely enjoy his videos. Absolutely, 100%. So yeah, no problem, man. It's true. If you ever do look back at any of my trip videos, you'll probably see some copycat type things there.
But, it's the best form of flattery. Thank you.
Yeah, that's it. But yeah, so until next time, thank you very much for watching. Adios. So here's the outro crew bit. Is there anything you'd like to ask or say to the outro crew?
Thank you very much for sticking with us and coming right through, on behalf of Michael as well.
It means the world to know that you folks are out there, and it does mean a lot to know that you watch it all the way to the end.
Absolutely.
And support us like that. So thank you very much.
Yep, I think that's it. Good luck.